Science fiction author Arthur C. Clarke said, "Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Remarkable, memorable experiences in modern stadiums, airports, transportation hubs, and smart cities transform public perception. Intelligent digital signs and smart sensors provide the opportunity to impress and amaze while serving the public. Scala, a leading global technology company, powers millions of digital signs around the world. Visit Scala.com today to start the conversation about bringing digital transformation to your modern venue."
I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show, and this is the Scala Report with Chris Riegel, who is the CEO of Scala.com, a leading digital technology company that spans the world, and Chris travels through all parts of it. However, I want to speak to something that is also global, which is the anxiety of the digital age, the digital social media age. We have access now to information that did not exist in the 20th century unless you were a genius at getting it out of libraries, and even then it wasn't as up-to-date as news when you hit the button on the search. Chris, the anxiety has reached a point where The Economist features the story of an experiment in which volunteers gave up Facebook for a finite period of time, 30 days or 60 days, and they were asked about how it affected the quality of life. The driver for this is that Facebook, which I find a benign environment compared to, say, Twitter, Facebook has linked people in an unhappy or unhealthy way, obliging them to spend way too much time looking at the digital screen and very little time either interacting with other human beings or getting on with their lives, similar to what we did in the 20th century. So in your travels, do you find this anxiety expressed? Because Scala.com is built on a model of wanting more information for everyone to be sharing with each other and not less. Good evening to you, Chris.
Good evening, John. I think what you see with Facebook and with many of the social media platforms in certain cases are that they amplify characteristics, maybe somewhat like a drug or alcohol, where those people that might have personality disorders or look for validation become somewhat addicted to the platforms. The CNBC commentator Joe Kernan described it best one day on the show to say Facebook is the intersection of narcissism and exhibitionism. And that's probably one of the best descriptions I've ever heard. But people that seek to be validated or seek to be updating or seek to become infatuated with that information flow, Facebook is the perfect drug for them.
2.3 billion people on Facebook. That's the number that The Economist gives out, and I have no reason to challenge it. It's a big number, given that we're about 7 or 8 billion people all told. That is impossible to ignore if you're in the business of commerce or capitalism or profit. So therefore, it is an environment we must engage in if we're to profit or to participate. Joe Kernan and others are speaking to the anxiety created by bad actors or people who are misrepresenting themselves. But if you're driving a business, you've got to make yourself available to customers that you have and customers that you want. Do you find a different experience? Do you find your customers anxious about constant communication?
I think Facebook specifically, and I'd first say of those 2.3 billion people, how many of those people are real versus bots or manufactured people for the advertising value of those people to certain constituencies? Second, if you look at platforms, Facebook for a Western society is very powerful, but go to China where you have WeChat and other platforms. There are others on a global basis that are as, if not more important because of the populations they serve. Secondarily, these platforms are all they have a shelf life. Look at MySpace and how many people were on MySpace and now gone. What will replace Facebook? Will there be new and better and different platforms at the point that a Kylie Jenner as a social influencer says, hey, this is not cool anymore? How many people divert and go to other platforms? I think you'll see more fragmentation, more different platforms, and more subgrouping, not unlike what you might see in the news business, that people will respond to platforms and consume media that aligns to their views of the world.
I did a minor experiment, anecdotal. I wandered around looking at how people were using their iPhones, because the young people use their iPhones constantly here in New York City, and it's crowded sidewalks, so you can see what everybody's doing. And searching Facebook news pages seems to be very popular if you're not getting email every 40 seconds, which is what you and I get. Now, that is something like an addiction. And in this experiment featured by The Economist columnist, Free Exchange, it notes that for people who were off Facebook for 30 days or more, several weeks after the deactivation period, in other words, when they came back on, they found that they had spent 23% less time on those who had never left Facebook. So clearly there's an aspect of this digital media that's unnecessary, something like eating potato chips. You just can't stop yourself.
Well, I think there's also a chemical dependency there. When you look at human hormones like dopamine that come out. When you're looking for information, you find that information, there's a gratification, a shot of dopamine within the system. So there's literally a physiological addiction in some people, it really across the population, that can be worse or excited in some people, that they become dependent on that for that dopamine, that bit of satisfaction that comes from checking that status, checking for the latest updates. Those are the points at which that becomes more of a almost Pavlovian response, and people become addicted to platforms like this.
When I get into an elevator in New York City and everybody's on their iPhones scanning Facebook or whatever they're doing, I feel strange, and I want to participate with them, especially if I'm carrying a book. I resist as much as possible, but it's human nature to join the sheep herd. So I want to switch to another anxiety that The Economist also features, which is the idea of a borderless border, because our digital signals on our iPhones or whatever smartphone we're carrying are available to certain types of technology when you cross a border. Now, Chris, you travel a great deal. You fly, I think you said, close to 200 times a year. I travel also, not quite as heroically, but I do travel. And the idea of having an iPhone that gets me through borders or through customs is very attractive. Is it attractive to you? And what about this anxiety that people don't want to be transparent?
I think that it's very attractive, but there has to be a second form of authentication. I'll use the example, I was out of the country earlier this week. I'm part of the Global Entry Trusted Traveler System. So in that footprint, you have two forms of authentication, one a passport, second fingerprint. The question is not necessarily what is the right platform for the good people, but what is the way that you have a platform and proper security for the bad people, the adverse actors that will try to game a system. Any form of technology can be beaten one way or another, and that's where in a border crossing environment, the simple instincts of that Homeland Security person doing the interview or checking to make sure that even if your device says you are who you say you are, that you're acting right, that you're not suspicious, that there's a second form of authentication. So will you ever see fully transparent border environments? Probably not.
However, the border does then acquire the information that's in your iPhone. Is that a good thing?
It certainly can be in some of our practices where we do data security and intelligence for governments, that ability to know that, hey, maybe this particular phone at a border crossing has been watching jihadi videos on YouTube or gone to sites that are of concern, and maybe that person deserves a secondary screening. There are proper uses of that, but again, the question comes in the governmental use case, what information are you giving to government, and how do you unring that bell in the future if it becomes too aggressive from a surveillance state standpoint?
Now, standing back from both these anxieties, Facebook and crossing a border, I'm puzzling if this is generational, Chris, because I watch Gen Z, or whatever's coming after Gen Z, children who were with their parents, who have what looks to be an iPad or a cell phone, that a mobile their phone their mother hands them, and they are gifted at it. They start, I mean, these are 4, 5, or 6-year-olds punching up the screen. So I'm guessing that as we move into the 21st century, this idea about anxiety, those of us who remember a non-digital age, will fade. Is that a measure that you think, or do you think this will always be with us because people are worried about their privacy?
You'll see a reaction at some point, whether that's a year, 5 years, 10 years, where people understand that anything that is put up on the internet at any time survives potentially forever. And the customer can make that choice. The consumer can make that choice. The beauty in society today is that while we make these trade-offs and say, I'm willing to allow the government to track my location on my cell phone in exchange for the government having the ability to send police and fire if I need to do a 911 call, you make that trade-off. Same thing at the border crossing. I'm willing to register my fingerprints with the government to have a 2-minute line through security versus a 45-minute line versus in security. So it comes down to what does that person's lifestyle and comfort level align to, and then you can choose the services that you do or do not want based on your level of comfort and the benefit of that service.
This is the Scala Report with Chris Riegel, who is the CEO of Scala.com, a leading digital technology company around the world. And we've been discussing the digital age and the anxiety of the digital age. I'm John Batchelor.